Hello students, in this lecture we will be continuing the discussion about the analysis of beams by the flexibility matrix method. We will discuss some of the examples related to the analysis of indeterminate beam using the flexibility matrix method. In the previous lecture we have seen an example of a continuous beam in which we have analyzed and we have calculated the final forces. Also, we have drawn the bending moment diagram for the same. In this lecture, we will consider this beam. It is a continuous beam having four supports. First support is at A is hinge. Second support at B is a roller. Third support at C is a roller support. Also, the fourth support at D is the roller support. Here in this example, we are concerned to calculate all the forces, final forces in this system. That means we have to do the analysis of this continuous beam, and the matrix method which we use in the analysis of this particular beam is called the flexibility matrix method. And this beam, the flexural rigidity, that is EI, is constant throughout. That means it is same in the position AB, BC and CD. So, in the position AB, a UDL is applied of intensity 20 kN per meter. In the position BC, point load of 60 kN per meter, point load of 60 kN, not per meter, it will be only kN is acting. Also, in the position CD, UDL of intensity 10 kN per meter is acting. A span of AB is 12 meters, span of BC is also 12 meters, and a span of CD is also 12 meters. So first step will be to calculate the degree of static indeterminacy in this case. So degree of static indeterminacy in this case will be like this. In this case, this is a hinge support, this is a roller, this is also a roller support, and this is also a roller support. So total number of internal reaction in this case will be 2, this is 1, 1, 1, that is 5. Number of equilibrium condition will be 3, 5 minus 3, that is equals to 2. The degree of the static indeterminacy for this particular beam will be 2. So at least 2 coordinates we have to select in order to analyze this beam. So coordinate number 1, we have selected the point B, and coordinate number 2, we have selected the point C. So next step will be to remove all the redundancy and make the structure, release structure. This is a release structure. It will be like this: AB simply supported beam, BC also simply supported beam, and CD also a simply supported beam. So next step will be to draw the BMD of this, and later we'll convert it to M upon EI diagram. So due to this load UDL, the variation of bending moment will be parabolic shape. Due to this point load, it will be a triangular shape, and due to this UDL again, it will be a parabolic shape. We'll see here it is a parabolic, it is a triangular, and it is also a parabolic. But the intensity will differ, because in this case, case AB, the intensity of the load is 20 kN per meter, whereas in the case of CD, the intensity of load is 10 kN per meter. So this is the calculation, that is 20 was the intensity of load, W multiplied by L, L was the span, that is 12 meters, WL square divided by 8. This comes to be 360 kN per meter, 360 kN meter, and this 360 upon EI, this will give us the M upon EI diagram. So this is how the M upon EI diagram looks like for a particular case. Now again, for this case, the maximum coordinate load will be WL by 12, so it will be 60 multiplied by 4. multiplied by 8 divided by 12. So it is 160 kilonewton meter. Again, for the quotient CD, it will be WL square by 8. So it is, it comes out to be 180 kilonewton meter. It is a simple bending moment calculation. So we have just converted it to M upon EI diagram because it will be a BS2 for the conjugate beam. Because this was the normal beam, and we know that in case of when we make the conjugate beam of this real beam, it will be same because the supports are hinged and roller, they remains the same. So now first next step will be to calculate the displacement loads due to the acting load. So in the coordinate direction one, that's this displacement due to the acting load will be delta 1L, and in the coordinate direction two, the displacement due to acting load will be delta 2L. So delta 1L will be like this. It is, this is coordinate direction one, sorry, this is a coordinate direction one, this is coordinate direction two. The first coordinate is here and second coordinate is here. So delta 1L will give the value of the displacement at coordinate number one. So what is the value? That is simply, we know that rotation of AB at B and rotation of BC at B. So rotation of AB at B is simply R1B, and rotation of BC at B is simply R2B, as we have discussed in the previous lecture, that it will be a sum of this RB1 plus RB2. So this is RB1 and this is RB2. So RB1 will be what? RB1 will be the will be due to the parabolic shape load, and RB2 will be due to the triangular load. So it is half into base into height multiplied by 2/3 plus half into base is 12 into height and multiplied by the total intensity of the load. So this will give the value 1973.33 upon EF. Now similarly, in the same way, we need to calculate the displacement in the coordinate direction 2 due to the acting load, and coordinate direction 2 will be this. Again, here will be RC1 dash plus RC2 dash. So again, this is R1L plus R2L. So we can write half into base. This is a triangular load, same as in this case. Just the difference will be, here we have taken a distance as 8. Here it will be 12. Oh, sorry, 4. Because the load is not acting on a center, it is acting at a distance of 8 meters from one end. So it is it will be calculated by solving this equation, and the value comes to be 1146.67 upon EI. So the next step will be to calculate the displacement due to the unit load. So first of all, we'll apply a unit load in the coordinate direction 1 and 2, and we'll see the rotation components. So there is the first rotation component, that is the first displacement component will be L11. When we have applied a unit rotation or a unit load in a coordinate direction 1, so the M upon EI diagram for this will be same. Here it will give no effect, so the intensity will be zero. But in this case, it will be like this, and it is a triangular load. So L11 will be when unit load is applied at coordinate direction 1, and the impact is also seen in the coordinate direction 1 itself. So it will be RB1 plus RB2, because the shear at this point will be RB1, and the shear at this point will be RB2. RB1 can be easily calculated to be 2 by 3 of half. Half is because the whole load is distributed into is distributed to this end, also this end. So this is a simple equation, and the equation turns out to be to give the value of 8 upon EI. Similarly, this del 21 represents that the unit load is still applied at in coordinate direction 1, but its impact is seen on coordinate direction 2. So here we are talking about this point. So it will be simply 1 upon 3 of 1 upon 2 into 12 into 1 upon EI. This will give the value 2 upon EI. Now, after this, what we'll do, we'll apply a unit in both the cases, we have applied a unit load in coordinate direction 1 because the J value is 1, but the I value changes from 1 to 2. Now, what we'll do, apply unit load in the coordinate direction 2. So, in this way, we have applied a unit load in coordinate direction 2. And its M upon EI diagram again will be like this. Again, when it is applied in this case, over here at this coordinate, this beam will be unaffected. So again, del 1,2 will give the value of the displacement component when the load is applied at the coordinate direction 2 and its response is seen in the coordinate direction 1. So we are concerned at this point. So it will be simply reaction at reaction RB dash in conjugate beam, and the reaction RB dash can be easily calculated using the equilibrium condition, and the value comes to be 1 upon 3 multiplied by 1 upon 2 multiplied by 12 multiplied by 1 upon EI, that is 2 upon EI. Now again, this is del 2,2. Del 2,2 is when the unit load is applied in coordinate direction 2 and its impact is also seen in coordinate direction 2 only. So that means we are concerned about this point, and we can see that this point will give the total value of RC, that is combination of RC1 dash and RC2 dash. So RC1 dash we can calculate easily. Let me give you a thing like for this particular load. If this is RC1 dash, obviously this will be RB2 dash. This will be RB2 dash. So what will be the value of RB2 dash? We can simply calculate by using equilibrium equation. That is RB2 dash plus RC1 dash, that is this thing, is equals to the load of this triangle, that is half into base is 12 multiplied by height is 1 upon EI. That is 1 upon EI. So this will give the load of this whole triangle, that is half into base into height. And we can, by using second equilibrium equation, what we can do, we can simply take a moment about any of the end. For example, if we take moment about this end, the total moment will be RB2 dash multiplied by 12. This is up clockwise, so it will be positive, minus this triangular load, that is half into 12 into 1 upon EI, multiplied by the distance where it is acting. So it will be acting, this will be the centroid, and this distance will be simply what it will be, 1 upon 3 times the 12. So this is how we can calculate RB2 dash, and this is what written over here. And similarly, in this case also, the total sum will be RC1 dash plus RC2 dash. RC1 dash will come from this equation itself. And for RC2 dash, we need to do the same procedure for this triangle also. The equation for this triangle will be RC2 dash plus, this is RD, is equals to load of this triangle, and the load of this triangle is also same, it is half into base is 12 and the height is 1 upon EI. So this is how we can calculate the value of RC2 dash, and will and the total del 22 at this point will be the combination of RC1 dash and RC2 dash. So this will come can be calculated to be 8 upon EI. So this is how we can calculate the value of RC1 dash and RC2 dash, and we can easily calculate the value of del 12 and del 22. So it is a very simple thing. Just we need to understand the concept of this thing in order to apply and solve, analyze the whole system. So the next step will be we need to form the matrix. This is a matrix, that is delta. Matrix delta is a combination of all these things. Matrix delta is combination of set of matrix del 11, matrix del 12, that is del 21, and del 22. This is a complete matrix. And this matrix is the nothing but the matrix del. That is a flexibility. So the value of del 11 we have already calculated. The value of del 11 we have calculated over here. It is 8 upon EI. Value of del 21 it is 2 upon EI. Value of del 12 it is 2 upon EI, and the value of del 22 is 8 upon EI. See, we have substituted the value of del 11 over here. We have substituted the value of del 12 over here. Again del 21 and del 22. On solving this matrix, we'll get the value of the whole and we put the same value in the compatibility equation. In this case here, 1 upon EI has been taken out. So the net and the inside portion will consist of 8, 8, 2 and 2. This is, we can easily see this is a diagonal matrix. So in this case, we have not specified any kind of yielding of support. So the value of del 1 and del 2 will be 0. Total del matrix will be 0. This, we have put this value. We already know compatibility equation. We have substituted the values in the compatibility equation. We have studied in the previous lecture. And this is how we can calculate the value of F1 and F2. F1 is the force. And remember, F1 is again, I'm telling you, F1 is a force in the coordinate direction 1. This F1 is a force in the coordinate direction 1. And F2 is force in the coordinate direction 2. So F1 and F2 will come out to be like this. This will go this side, and it will be inverse of this matrix. Inverse of this matrix can be calculated like this. This is 1 upon this multiplication of this diagonal terms. This is 8 multiplied 8 is 64. Minus 2 multiplied by 2 is 4. Inside portion, what diagonal portion will change its sign. This is 8, this is 8, this is minus 2, and this is minus 2. This portion will be as it is. Again, on solving this, we will get the final terms. That is, F1 is equals to minus 2 to 4.89, and F2 is equals to 87.11. So these are the final forces that we have calculated for this case. F1 is a final force that we need to concern in the coordinate direction 1, and F2 is a final force that we need to calculate in the coordinate direction 2. Similarly, this is the final diagram. This is what we have. This is how we have applied the unit load, but the difference what we have applied the unit load, you can see over here in the first figure, this coordinate selected, we have selected this unit load in this direction, but the value comes out to be negative. That simply represents that we have to change its direction. So it will now act like this. It will act like this upward, and here also the value is negative. See, value of F1 and F2 both is negative, so it will, we have to change its direction, so its direction will be like this. The value of F1 was 2 to 4, and the value of 0.89, and the value of F2 was 87.11. So here 2 to 4.89 and 87.11. This is a complete release structure, and we have calculated the final forces. Now what we have to do, we have to draw the bending moment diagram for the same. Now the bending moment diagram for the present loading will be like this parabola, because of and the UDL. This triangle, because of the concentrated load, and again this UDL, this parabola, because of the UDL loading. Now this is 2 to 4.89 due to coordinate load, and this is 87.11. The net motion that is under this region will be the effective bending moment diagram for the complete beam. So this is how we have realized this beam in this case also, and we can do the same for the other problems as well. Again, there are simple steps for the calculation and analyzing the beam. First of all, we need to calculate the static indetermination of any beam. Then we are concerned to solve and analyze the beam using the conjugate beam method. For that, we need to draw the bending moment diagram. Before that, we need to make the structure release. And for the release structure, we'll draw the M upon EI diagram. After drawing the M upon EI diagram, we know that according to conjugate beam theorem, the M upon EI diagram will be the loading diagram for the conjugate beam. So it will be a loading diagram. Due to that loading diagram, with the help of this, we'll calculate del 1L. This is del 1L. Again, this is del 2L. This is a displacement due to load in coordinate direction 1, and this is displacement due to load in coordinate direction 2. This is simply we have applied a conjugate beam theorem that says that if we need to calculate displacement in a real beam, that will be same as the shear in the shear force in the conjugate beam. So this is what we have calculated. We have calculated the shear force, and we have simply added to get the final displacement. Similarly for the second unit, the second coordinate also. Then the next step, what we have done is we have applied a unit load in each coordinate direction. First we have applied a unit load of 1 kN in the coordinate direction 1, and we have drawn the bending moment, M upon EI diagram, and we have calculated the displacement component, that is del 11 and del 21. Remember, del 11 and del 21, both the cases, the unit load is applied to coordinate direction 1 only, but the difference is in the first case, in case of del 11, its effect is seen on the first coordinate itself, whereas in the second case, its effect is seen on the second coordinate. Then we have applied a unit load in the second coordinate direction, and again we have calculated del 12 and del 22, and this will complete our flexibility matrix, and we can simply substitute the values in this del matrix, and we'll put all these values in the compatibility equation, and we'll get the final forces. After getting the final forces, we'll check whether the sign is positive or negative. If the sign is negative, it simply means the sign, the direction which we have assumed simply needs to change. But if the sign is positive, it means the direction will be same as we have taken. So by this, we'll draw the final release structure diagram, and we'll write the values that we have calculated for F1 and F2. With the help of, when we are known to everything, we'll simply draw the bending moment diagram, and the net portion, this shaded portion, will give the net bending moment diagram for the whole beam. This is how we can see this analysis, and I hope this would have given you a clear idea about the approach of doing the questions in the flexibility matrix method. So in the next upcoming lectures, we'll be discussing some more cases. Remember something, there are the major cases which we need to consider for both flexibility as well as the stiffness matrix method. The first is for a beam. There are many beams, like we'll be dealing with a continuous beam, we'll be dealing with cantilever beams. Then the second case, for this same case, we'll be analyzing using the flexibility as well as the stiffness matrix method. Then the second case will be of plate frame, that is also called a rigid frame, rigid jointed frame. For the same rigid jointed frame, we'll be analyzing the beam using both methods, that is flexibility as well as the stiffness matrix method. Then the third will be analysis of a rigid jointed frame, analysis of a pin jointed trusses. in the analysis of when you enter traces also, we'll be analyzing the beam using the both methods, that is a flexibility and a stiffness method. So in this module, particular module, we'll be discussing about all these cases, and we'll simply by the end of this module, we'll be able to understand the concept and the method and the right approach of selecting any case and analyzing by using either of these two methods. Okay, class, till then, thank you. We'll discuss more cases in the upcoming lectures. Thank you, class.